Chapter 2. Delay Calculation. In this chapter, we are going to talk about the delay calculation. At first, STA constructs the logic connectivity after the netlist is read in and the design is linked. During a timing update, this database is populated with timing values from delay calculation. STA convert the actual circuit into a map of nodes and calculate the delay between any two nodes. As the graph represents the entire design, all possible timing paths are contained within the graph. The graph gets its name from its representation of the design as a node graph. The ports and pins in the design become the nodes in the graph, and the timing arcs become the connections between the nodes. Timing arcs. Timing arcs refers to the connection between input pin and output pin of the same cell. We have two types of cells in the design, the combinational gates and sequential cells such as flops and latches. They have different types of timing arcs. For a combinational cell, such as inverter, buffer, NAND, or gate, the timing arc is simply connection between each input and its output. For sequential cells, it is more complicated. It has clock to data arc, clock to reset arc, clock to output arc. The clock to data arc is actually where the setup and hold checks come from. The clock to output is the propagation path of the sequential cell. Timing sense. Obviously, for every timing arc, the signal could go up and down. So the transition could be rise and fall. We define the timing sense as three types of unitness. Positive unate timing arcs are the arc where input and output signal holds the same direction of transition. A rising transition on an input causes the output to rise or to be unchanged. A falling transition on an input causes the output to fall or to be unchanged. For example, if the B input of this AND gate is 1, the gate will become transparent to the A input, so output transition follows A pin. If the B input of this AND gate is 0, the gate output will stuck at 0, so any change on A pin won't cause a change on the output. Vice versa, the negative unate timing arcs are the ones where output transition has opposite direction of transition from the input waveform. A rising transition on an input causes the output to fall or to be unchanged. A falling transition on an input causes the output to rise or to be unchanged. Non-unate arcs are the ones whose output transition cannot be simply determined by single input. The output transition also depends upon the state of the other inputs. Such as the XOR gate, if the B input is 0, then the rising transition on A pin will cause output also rise. If the B input is 1, then the rising transition on A will cause output to fall. Timing path. From the synopsis definition, a timing path is a point-to-point sequence through a design that starts at a register clock pin or an input port, passes through combinational logic elements, and ends at a register data input pin or an output port. What the timing path is describing is whenever there is a data switching happens at the start point, the signal propagates through the cloud of logic gates, doing some logic operation, then reach the endpoint. Valid path means the path represent a real functional transaction. The signal has to go through the cloud of logic and to be captured by the endpoint in order to have the design functioning well. This type of path should be the one we care about in STA. Leakage path mean even though the path from the start point and to the endpoint exists topologically since STA is doing an exhaustive check on all possible path trace combinations, it is not required functionally for the chip to operate. This type of path sometimes could happen and we should ignore them. Don't care path is a more of a constraint issue. If there a timing path reported by the tool but the start point holds a static value, for example, some pre-programmed configuration register, then the start point won't be toggled during normal functional operation. There is no point to check the timing path for this start point. We can set false path from this start point, but to deal with this kind of path requires related design knowledge. Late and early path. Now let's talk about what is the longest path and shortest path. This concept is simple but often get wrong to people who are new to STA. In general, there are multiple timing paths through which the logic can propagate to the required destination point. The actual path taken depends upon the state of the other inputs along the logic path. Max path, namely the longest path or so-called late path, means the path with the largest delay between two endpoints. This type of path is usually used for setup check. Min path, also referred as the shortest path or early path, means the path with the smallest delay between two endpoints. This type of path is usually used for hold check. Don't confuse max or min path with max or min delay. For the same start or endpoint pair, max path and min path can be two completely different timing path consist of different sets of gates. Max delay and min delay for a given cell refers to delay through timing arc of the same cell. The delay difference is due to different stimuli applied to the analysis to modeling process variation and worst slow merge scenario. Drive strength. Another important concept in STA is the drive strength of a library cell. The ability for a cell to drive a load is inversely related to its output resistance. The output resistance and the load capacitance forms a RC network. If the resistance is small, the CMOs can charge the output load more quickly. To achieve a smaller resistance, we can increase the width of the MOSFET so the equivalent resistance becomes smaller since multiple R segment in parallel. Cell delay. Let's go over another basic concept of cell propagation delay, which I believe most of you should already heard of. We know that due to capacitive loading from the parasitic on the wire, which must be charged or discharged in order to raise or drop the voltage level on a net, there will be a finite time for the signal to transition. That is where the rise and fall transition or slew rate come from. Transition time is traditionally measured as time required from 10% to 90% of the transition for both rise and fall. Slew is the inversion of transition time. The larger the transition time, the slower the slew. However, the slew threshold is chosen to correspond to the linear portion of the transition waveform. So for relatively new generation of technology node, the slew threshold is usually chosen from 30% to 70%. Propagation delay is the main source of the gate delay. It stands for the time needed to propagate through the logic cell itself. If the transition time is ideal, namely zero, then the propagation delay is purely the delay between two transition edges. However, since we have finite transition time, the propagation delay is now defined as delay between 50% of the input waveform and to 50% of the output waveform. The propagation delay of a cell is a function of input transition of each inputs and the output load capacitance. Cell delay model. Delay calculation is performed for one stage at a time, where a stage consists of the driving cell arc, the output RC network, and the capacitance of the network load pins. Given an input slew or waveform at the driver input, the goal of delay calculation is to compute the response at the driver output and at the input of the receiver pins. The computed responses are then used to determine the cell delay for the driver and the input transition time at the load pins. The purpose of cell delay model is to provide a mathematical model for the STA tool to compute propagation delay through the driving cell. Remember that the all these model used in STA is trying to be correlated with real physics as close as possible, but they are not aimed to simulate the circuit, which SPICE simulation does. So all these delay models are a trade-off between runtime and accuracy. Currently in the industry, two major models are being used. Nonlinear delay model or the NLDM is a voltage-based delay calculation model which is widely used models representing the response characteristics of cells in the libraries. It is very simple and less time-consuming for the tools to obtain the response of the cells. This model uses two-dimensional tables to represent the cell delay, output slew, and other timing checks. In this method of modeling, the driver cell is modeled to be a Thevenin voltage source with resistance in series. The receiver is modeled to be a lumped load capacitor. The NLDM table is in the form of a two-dimensional table. Notice that the NLDM table is characterized under the condition where the output wire resistance is zero, since we have no idea what the load will be when just creating the library. The NLDM supports two methods of computing delay through a cell. Typically, we should specify the method that correlates best to the characterized library data. The two methods are: Number 1, performing table lookup and interpolation in a cell delay table provided in the library. This is the most commonly used method. Number 2, using the propagation and transition tables, following this equation. Delay of cell equals delay of propagation plus delay of transition. For a given library, if cell delay tables for a timing arc is provided, then the propagation delay tables must not be provided. Vice versa, if the propagation table is specified, then the cell delay table must not be provided. So the tool can only choose one of the method for delay calculation. Here is an example for timing arc and timing sense inside a normal library file. The pin section shows what the current pin to be characterized is. Here the pin name is Y and it is an output pin. It also tells you the associated power and ground, the direction, and the logic function generated on this pin. This section also contains design constraints such as max capacitance and max transition spec, which supposed to guide the physical design tool for optimization. The timing section shows the related pin for this particular arc, A1, which means the following table is describing the timing behavior for arc A1 to Y. As we can see, for an AND gate, the arc is a positive unate arc because the output is rising along with the A1 in case if A2 is a 1, or Y stays low if A2 is 0. Y will never be falling when A1 is rising. Note that there are two tables show up here, the cell rise and rise transition. The cell rise is the direct cell delay lookup table showing cell delay when the signal is rising up. It uses input transition and output load as index to interpolate the entire cell delay through the cell. The rise transition table describes the output transition time based on input transition and output load. It can be used as input transition to next stage after applicable slew rate degradation. If there are propagation table provided in library, the second method of calculating cell delay can be used as well. Regarding to how the STA tool interpolate delay values based on pre-characterized input transition and output load pair, we can think it as the picture draw below. Let's say we are given an input transition of 0.09 and output load 0.67. Four nearest pre-characterized points in the cell delay lookup table is highlighted in the rectangle. In a three-dimensional graph, the cell delay value of these four points forms a plane. We can use a simple equation to model, z equals a plus bx plus cy plus dxy. To interpolate the corresponding cell delay using these four points, the first step is to solve the hidden coefficients, namely the variable a, b, c and d. This can be easily done by substitute the data points into the equations. Once the coefficients are revealed, then the cell delay can be calculated for the given input transition or output load combination. The main limitation of NLDM is it failed to take into account the resistive effect on the interconnection wire. In deep submicron technology, the impedance of the net is in comparable range with the driver resistance. Thus, the resistive impact on the wire cannot be simply ignored anymore. The cell output waveform with RC load is very different from the waveform with a single capacitive load. Let's look at the example of an inverter. As the input waveform rising up, the output waveform falls down. The parasitic of the wire and load pin can be modeled as a distributed RC network. This RC network can be further estimated by a RC pi model where the total capacitance consists of near-end capacitance plus far-end capacitance, but with a resistive wire in between. Thus, near-end capacitance will be charged quicker than far-end capacitance because of the resistive wire. The output waveform for the actual load will be crossing the 50% transition bar at a much earlier timestamp than when using total capacitance of the wire for delay calculation. Recall that the NLDM table is characterized under the condition where the output wire resistance is zero, so it cannot be used directly. We have to modify that model in order to make the table useful again. The most widely used method today is to introducing an effective capacitance. The idea of effective capacitance is to obtain an equivalent output capacitance CEF which produce the same delay through the driver cell as the original design with the actual RC load. However, the effective capacitance only ensures the delay to the 50% waveform transition bar is matching up the actual RC load. It doesn't provide a matching output waveform with the actual load. That means the accuracy of transition from this method is not considered. We can see because of the interconnection resistance, the capacitance seen from the driver output is actually smaller than the total cap on the wire. This effect is called resistive shielding. If the interconnect resistance is negligible, the effective capacitance is nearly equal to the total resistance. If the interconnect resistance is very large, the effective capacitance is almost equal to the near-end capacitance, extreme cases like an open circuit. Resistive shielding is a very important concept in advanced technology node. This phenomenon is dominant in case of long wire and make the wire delay calculation pessimistic. Because of this, when we want to improve the RC delay of a wire, it's better to reduce the resistance at the near end of the drive output so it can reduce the inaccuracy of the delay model and improve overall delay. Let's see another example of calculating the cell delays through a standard library cell. Assuming there is a rising signal transition at the input of the inverter. Since its output will be falling, it is a negative unate arc. From the library of this inverter, we can read the cell fall table to interpolate the cell delay through this inverter. We can also derive the output falling transition time according to the fall transition lookup table. Note that if there are multiple arcs converging at the output, the worst transition time among all the arcs will be picked for calculation afterwards. Then the signal goes through a RC network, which will widen the transition time even further. This is called slow degradation. When it reaches the input of the next stage, in this case it is the NAND gate, the pulse is used as the input transition to the NAND gate. Since the NAND gate is also having a negative unate arc, we are going to use the cell rise table and rise transition table for the cell delay and transition time calculation. When driver resistance is in order of magnitude less than the impedance of the net, driver model requires more granularity. Even though one can use effective capacitance method to enhance the NLDM model, in this case it still cannot satisfy the accuracy requirement anymore. Many industry EDA tools has enabled composite current source model to overcome the shortage of NLDM. The composite current source model, or simply called CCS model, consists of two parts. The first part is the driver model. Composite current source driver model is a time-varying, voltage-dependent nonlinear current source. It works with any net topology, including high-impedance nets, works with complex cells, including stacked transistors, works with non-monotonic behavior, including Miller effect. CCS driver model is a set of waveforms recording extracted current versus their corresponding timestamp. It is characterized by capturing current waveform flowing into the load capacitor of the cell. It is essentially a current source with infinite driver resistance, hence it provides better accuracy in cases where net impedance is very high. CCS driver model also has sensitivity to input transition time, output load, and side input states. This would help in modeling the cell delay accurately due to the R effect on the interconnection. These characterization experiments are repeated for a table of different input transition and output load combinations. The current through C out is saved for every circuit simulation time step and then reduced to a much smaller set of current and time points, namely the IT pairs. When to use this driver model on an actual circuit, the first step is to calculate an effective capacitance from the reduced order RC network. Then we can apply the output current table. When we apply these currents to their respective capacitances, we can reconstruct the voltage waveforms. If we are presented with an output capacitance that we did not pre-characterize with, we can interpolate between the currents to predict the resulting waveform. Similarly, if we are presented with an input slew that we did not used for pre-characterizing, we can also interpolate. The second part is the receiver model. Due to interconnection RC and nonlinear capacitance from the input devices of the load, the receiver capacitance value varies at different points on the transitioning waveform. In CCS model, this capacitance is modeled differently in the leading portion of waveform versus the trailing portion of the waveform. For each input slew and output load combination, the model provides two different values C1 and C2 to be used for delay calculation. This two-capacitance approach enables a dynamic calculation that closely matches circuit simulation for load inputs that having nonlinear capacitance. Taking the CCS driver model as an example, in the DUT-LIB timing model, the first two indexes are still input transition and output capacitance, but an extra index column is added to describe the timestamp of the current waveform. Now the value table holds a list of output current value under the combination of certain input transition, output capacitance, and certain timestamp. One drawback of traditional CCS model is it requires too many sample points and data sets. Conventional CCS timing driver models require you to describe each CCS driver switching current waveform by sampling data points. As the number of timing arcs increase in a standard cell library, the CCS timing library size can become very large. We know so far, the CCS model is current versus time, namely in IT domain. But we can also characterize the transition process using current versus voltage, namely in IV domain. Rather than use timestamp-based current and voltage curve, compact CCS models current versus voltage curve. The benefit of characterize the transition in IV domain is the transition curve is much smoother than IT domain or VT domain, so we can reconstruct the curve much more easily and reduce the storage space. Notice that the IV switching curves are usually convex, and they have no inflection point in the middle, a feature that facilitates compact modeling. For a given IV curve, we can split it into two halves. Each half will be matched with a pre-characterized base curve. To exactly match the IV curve, only 6 parameters are needed. I initial, switching current value at the starting point. I peak, peak switching current value. V peak, voltage value when current reaches peak value. T peak, time when current reaches peak value. Left ID, reference ID number of the base curve to match the left half. Right ID, reference ID number of the base curve to match the right half. Compared with the traditional CCS method, which may need 20 to 30 sample data sets to describe the same transition process, the compact CCS method consumes much less space to store the data. Compact model that uses indirectly shared base curves to model the shape of switching curves. By allowing each base curve to model multiple switching curves with similar shapes, the modeling efficiency is improved and the library size is compressed. Base curve and LUT template. Base curve group contains the detailed description of normalized base curves. It defines half curve waveform for the 4 switching waveform. Each base curve consists of attribute curve X and curve Y, where curve Y contains curve ID and the characterized data array. What comes along with the base curves group is the compact lookup table template. The template is a lookup table describes the current voltage waveform depending on input net transition as the first index and total output net capacitance as the second index. The waveform attribute is the third index of the data, which consists the six essential parameters stated above, namely, initial current, peak voltage, peak time, left base curve ID and right curve ID. The CCS compact driver model is to record a set of current versus voltage waveforms reconstructed from base curve and the corresponding compact LUT. For example, as shown in the picture, to describing the rise transition 4 waveform, it uses the CCS driver template demo which was defined in previous slide, and a number of lines is listed under the values bracket. Each line consists of 6 parameters, which tells the tool about key values to be used during reconstruction based on the base curve. The CCS receiver model is also another important component to achieve high accuracy with nonlinear effects of the transistor. In the two-region receiver capacitance model, the voltage rise or fall at an input or in-out node is divided into two regions and the corresponding capacitance values are stored as receiver capacitance 1 and receiver capacitance 2 lookup tables. These capacitances are dependent on the input slew and output load. It is recommended to use CCS receiver model along with the CCS driver model. Topic 7, state-dependent delay, conditional timing. State-dependent delay or conditional timing arc is very common in the library, especially for those logic gates who has multiple inputs. The timing model for a particular timing arc could change depending on the other inputs of the cell. Sometimes people want to distinguish one case from the other since the timing behavior could be largely different. Not only timing, but power also. So there are often several cases description for the same timing arc, one for each input's combination and also a default case. The rule of conditional timing arc is as following. 1. We use when statement to specify the condition. If the condition expression evaluates to true, the following timing values in that case are active. At the same time, the default case is disabled. 2. If there is state cannot be determined in a condition and result the entire condition to be undetermined state as well, the condition will still be evaluated to be true. 3. The timing engine will pick the worst active timing value for this particular timing arc. 4. To disable a particular conditional timing, we must force its condition to be known state false. Here is an example on the left. 1. There are 3 cases in parallel as shown on the left. When B is true, not true, or don't care. 2. If there is no case analysis set for input B, then all 3 cases will be active and taking into account by timing engine. It will pick the worst case rise or fall delay among all 3 cases for calculation. Usually the worst case is the default case. 3. If we set case analysis to make input B constant at one value, then only one of the above 2 cases will be picked and used during calculation. The default case is also disabled. Wire delay model. After talking about cell delay model, the other major part of stage delay lies in the interconnection delay. The main parasitic for nowadays interconnections are resistors and capacitors. Thus, the interconnection parasitic can be represented by an RC network. The value for the parasitic can be pre-layout estimation or post-layout extraction. In pre-layout phase, estimation of interconnection delay happens before the design has been actually routed. Implementation tool has to estimate wire delay to come up with solutions for logic optimization and placement. Wire load model is often used to estimate RC network. In post-layout phase, after the design is fully routed, we know the exact topology and length of the route. Extraction will be done to get the wire parasitic values, which forms a distributed RC network for later delay calculation. Parasitic extracted from PNR tool is often used here. RC tree. First of all, an important concept is all backend tool relies on RC tree topology. RC tree is a reduced order model for tool to calculate interconnection delay through a net. An RC tree meets the following three conditions. Has a single input source node. Does not have any resistive loops. All capacitances are between a node and ground. The most widely used wire estimation model is the wire load model. RC values per unit length of the wire are obtained from the library. Extraction data of already routed designs are used to build a fan-out to length table called the wire load model. They represent formulas which establish connection between interconnect delay and its geometrical sizes such as wire length, width, metal thickness. All nets with the same fan-out have the same estimated interconnect delay during front-end design. Naturally, it does not coincide with the reality. To further correlate with the physical implementation, the industry also tries to bring some place and route feature into delay estimation. Even though in STA tool all we need is just the parasitic values, it's better to know that in some implementation and optimization tool, they could estimate the wire based on an initial placer that can take in physical constraints like floor plan and technology file to perform some global routing and do wire estimation based on that. This way, the RC network topology is based on actual physical topology and RC value are derived from provided technology file. Wire load model. The wire load model illustrates how the length of the wire can be described as a function of fan-out. The model itself is essentially a lookup table for RC per unit length. For any fan-out number not explicitly listed in the table, the wire length is obtained using linear extrapolation with the specified slope. Note that for nets with same fan-out, no matter how they are routed eventually, they will get same wire delay estimation. All nets with the same fan-out have the same estimated interconnect delay, which is obviously not an accurate way to calculate wire delay. Here shows an example of the relation of fan-out length defined in library. On the left-hand side, we have two tables depict fan-out length slope ratio. Unit RC as long as length lookup table with respect to fan-out is listed out. On the right-hand side, since different wire load model may be applied to different cells based on the area, the wire load selection groups can tell the tool about what wire load table to pick in case of different design area. Wire load model has three RC tree topologies usually contained in their library. First is best case tree where the destination pin is physically adjacent to the driver. None of the wire resistance is in the path to the destination pin. The resistance contribution in the wire load models is set to zero. So in this case, the wire load contribution is purely capacitive. Total delay value can be obtained by directly reading from library NLDM table. The second one is the balanced tree where each destination pin is on a separate branch of the interconnect wire. Each path to the destination sees an equal portion of the total wire RC. The last one is worst case tree. All destination pins are clustered together at the far end of the wire. So each destination pin sees the total RC of the wire. In STA, we have to set up which topology to be used according to our application needs. But remember, all of these are just an early on estimation method for delay calculation. Parasitic and SPEF. In previous slides, we introduced the wire load model and RC tree topology used in pre-layout phase. After the design gets into post-layout phase, where the actual route is done, we usually use layout extraction tool to generate more accurate design parasitic values in format of SPEF. SPEF is an industry standard parasitic exchange format. SPEF contains distributed RLC interconnect values and corresponding coordinates for nodes. For example, on the left-hand side is a snapshot of a sample SPEF file. It describes a net topology along with RC values between all nodes as the figure shown on right-hand side. Topic 8, Parasitic Annotation Issue. In STA tool like PrimeTime, after the STA run is done, it can generate an annotation quality check for the parasitic. Usually what we care most is the internal pin-to-pin nets, but it could have driverless, loadless and constant nets in the design. Driverless nets mean the nets is not driven by any cells, so its input is left dangling. Loadless nets is on the contrary, it doesn't go anywhere and just floating. Constant net usually is caused by tie low or tie high cell, representing hard-coded values in the design. Even though above three special net categories are not uncommon, they do have some side effect to cause partial annotation issue in the timing analysis. Floating metal pieces in the signal routing could make exaction tool difficult to calculate the RC since there are an extra piece of geometry belong to the same logical nets. Let's see, during ECO phase, the layout engineer is trying to reroute a particular signal, so he created a new route, but for some reason he forgets to remove all of the original route and left over a small piece of metal. In this situation, even a small piece of extra metal could cause partial parasitic extraction issue. We need to be careful and remove all the dangling unused root shapes. Dangling ports and pins in RTL could confuse the tool as well. Without knowing what the driver and load is, timing analysis can't be done correctly on those nets, so ideally they should be eliminated from RTL or optimized away from logic synthesis tool like Design Compiler. Constant nets are not that concerning since they are quite static, but we also need to verify to make sure they are expected. Usually, we shouldn't have too many constant nets in the design since at the most of the time, constant means redundancy, so logic synthesis tool is working hard to optimize away any constant logic out of the design. The consequence of having annotation issue is tool could assume unrealistic delay value and create false violation. Timing results cannot be trusted on these problematic nets having annotation issue. Other nets might as well be impacted, so the accuracy of timing analysis degrades. Thus, we should try to eliminate as much annotation issue as possible to make STA analysis reliable.
Elmore delay calculation. After discussion about the RC tree topology, let's take a look at the algorithm EDA tool used to calculate the delay. Since all of the RC delay calculation method are based on RC tree, let's review what a RC tree is first. An RC tree must meet the following three conditions. Has a single input source. Does not have any resistive loops. All capacitances are between a node and ground. Thus, both wire load model and SPEFRC network are meeting the RC tree requirements. Once the parasitic value is obtained and RC tree topology is determined, we can calculate the wire delay based on the interconnection models. The easiest way is to use Elmore delay model. Mathematically, it uses the first moment of the RC tree transfer function to estimate the RC delay. It defined a shared path resistance between any of the two nodes in a RC tree, which is the sum of resistance on the common path from the source to both nodes. Elmore delay is the sum of product of the capacitance of each node in the RC tree and its corresponding shared path resistance with all other nodes. It is the simplest and most widely used method during the entire design phase. Elmore delay model only works for RC trees. It provides an accurate result for nodes that are far from the driving point. It can be inaccurate by orders of magnitude for those nodes that are near the driving point. This inaccuracy in Elmore delay calculation is primarily due to resistive shielding mentioned previously. The main application of Elmore delay calculation happens in pre-route database which don't have parasitic extracted yet. It is a reasonable method when analysis time is a concern and people want fast turnaround time. A more accurate but complicated method is by using high-order algorithm. Although the Elmore delay inaccuracy can be improved by corrective factors such as effective capacitance, there are more accurate methods that use higher-order moments of an RC circuit transfer function. However, these methods are all significantly more expensive to compute than the Elmore delay, and that makes them difficult to utilize within ASIC design tools. One of the more popular and accurate methods used in current physical design and timing analysis environment for estimating wire delay is asymptotic waveform evaluation, which will not be discussed here. Arnoldi delay calculation. During post-root phase, since we already have all the detail-rooted metal shapes, parasitic is a known factor, so we need to calculate delay more accurately than pre-root phase. Arnoldi delay calculation is usually used in place and root tool to take root parasitic into account. It helps to improve RC accuracy at cost of runtime. It is also very suitable to be used in case where net resistance is comparable to or large than the driver resistance. Topic 9, report delay calculation. In STA tool like PrimeTime, we sometimes need to have a detailed look at how the delay of a particular timing arc is calculated. There is a command called report delay calculation which can dump out some useful debug information to analyze. As we can see from the left side, for the fall transition cell delay, the cell U5070 has an input transition of 0.041 and an output capacitance of 0.800, thus the reported delay calculation is calculated out of the fall delay table in the library. The report delay calculation commands shows the relevant portion of the lookup table it picks from the library and how it calculates the earlier mentioned coefficients. From there the cell fall delay is calculated. And then we have to multiply it by the derouting factor to create some more margin, since this run is using wire load model, so it's optimistic. The calculated delay 0.063 multiplied by derouting factor 1.35 matches what's there in the timing report 0.085. Slew degradation. From the above analysis, we know that the output slew of the driver is not the same as the input slew seen by the load pin. The output slew of a driver depends on the input slew at this driver and the load capacitance seen from the output of this driver. The slew rate at load input pin depends on both the output slew of the driver and the slew degradation along path due to resistive nature of the wire. If this is a multiple fanout net, which means one driver drives more than one loads, each load pin can have a different slew rate at its input. This phenomenon is called slew degradation. Topic 10, Zero Interconnect Mode, in Design Compiler. Usually during the initial phase of logic synthesis, we want to analyze if the design is feasible without the impact of wire delay and buffer tree. If the design cannot meet timing with no interconnection delay, then there must be something fundamental problem about the logic to fit in the required cycle time. Design compiler provide us an option to forces the timer to ignore the contribution on a timing path from any wire capacitance in the design by setting zero interconnect delay mode to true. When the application variable set zero interconnect delay mode is set to true, the tool analyzes your design with only cell delays and the capacitance of the pin load on all the wires in the design to determine if your design meets timing goals. The tool does not consider wire capacitance due to timing paths. The command is used primarily in pre-placement and post-placement steps to assess design and constraint feasibility. It also helps when debugging potential missing timing exceptions in the constraints. Zero interconnect delay mode must not be used in the final implementation step. It is worth noting that, even in the zero interconnect mode, driver resistance and load pin capacitance still exist and being taken into account of delay calculation. Slew merge. Delay calculation is performed as the signal edge propagates in a forward direction across the logic path. If we were computing the timing on a chain of buffers, we will derive the input slew of the next stage from the output slew of previous stage, performing delay calculation and storing the results on the timing graph as we propagate along in the direction. However, when two slows arrive at the same point on the graph, static timing analysis tools like PrimeTime must choose one of these slows to propagate forward so it can continue delay calculation for the downstream logic. One common case is the output pin of a multi-fan-in cell where multiple timing arcs converging at These points where a slow must be chosen are called slow merge points. To ensure the min or max graph values always bound the fastest and slowest possible timing, the worst slow must be chosen and propagated forward. We can see that there is inherent pessimism in a graph representation of a design's timing. For the real physical device, a timing arc can have multiple timing behaviors depending on the upstream logic that sources its transition. However, a graph representation allows each timing arc to have only a single min or max rise or fall timing behavior. If we tried to store a value for every possible upstream path, we could have thousands or millions of values stored per arc, resulting in impossible memory and runtime requirements. To ensure the min or max graph values always bound the fastest and slowest possible timing, the worst slow must be chosen and propagated forward. Max delay and min delay. In static timing analysis, every timing arc is evaluated twice, once using the max stimuli and once using the min stimuli. When calculating delay for max delay arc, tool will pick maximum annotated lump capacitive wire load from max SPEF file. Maximum pin capacitance or receiver model from max timing library. Maximum slow propagation is performed at slow merge point when calculating cell delay. Vice versa, when calculating delay for min delay arc, tool will pick minimum annotated lump capacitive wire load from min SPEF. Minimum pin capacitance or receiver model are used from min timing library. Minimum slow propagation is performed at slow merge point when calculating cell delay. Analysis mode is about the way STA picking up delay values during its analysis. The simplest method is to use a single delay possibility across the entire chip. Every timing arc is evaluated as max delay arcs. Both setup and hold paths use the computed max delay arcs. That is, we use same library characterized in one operating condition for both max and min timing checks. The cell delay is deterministic and have only one possibility. However, this method does not reflect any process variation which happens in reality. The accuracy is very bad. That's why the best case worst case mode appears. When we set the STA in this mode, it reads in two sets of extreme delay values. The two sets of delay value can represent two PVT, process or voltage or temperature, which cannot physically coexist at the same time. The two corners in best case worst case mode represent two completely independent PVT corners. Setup paths use the longest path through the max delay arcs for launch, and the shortest path through the max delay arcs for capture. Hold paths use the shortest path through the min delay arcs for launch, and the longest path through the min delay arcs for capture. In other words, the best case worst case analysis mode only checks setup at the max corner, and hold at the min corner. It is important to remember that setup paths are not checked at the min corner, and hold paths are not checked at the max corner. This could miss timing violations due to differences in how the launch and capture paths track the PVT difference between the corners. The single and best case worst case analysis modes both have a serious accuracy limitation. Either the fast launch or capture paths are computed by using max delay arcs, or the slow capture path is computed by using the min delay arcs. These modes were suitable for designs in older technologies where slow sensitivity and slow variation were minimal. These modes can, however, result in optimism when used on modern small geometry designs. So the widely used mode nowadays is on-chip variation mode. In this mode, STA will also use two sets of delay values. The two sets of delay values represent two conditions which can physically coexist on the die at the same time. Setup paths use the longest path through the max delay arcs for launch, and the shortest path through the min delay arcs for capture. Hold paths use the shortest path through the min delay arcs for launch, and the longest path through the max delay arcs for capture. On top of this, we usually apply some scaling factor to make the situation even more restrictive. The OCV is an effective way to guard ban the design, but it could be too pessimistic due to all the reasons above. We will talk about how to reduce its pessimism while keep the accuracy in a later chapter. Timing window. One place that easy to get confused by people new to STA is the timing window. It is nothing but the possible range of arrival time for a signal to arrive certain timing node. We know that there could be multiple different paths reaching one common node in a timing path. They could have gone through different type of logic gates, different amount of gates, experience different process variation and cross-stock effect, so certainly the arrival time is different. The timing window is simply the window between the earliest possible switching time of a node and the latest possible switching time. The calculation of timing window is very important in graphic-based analysis and that affect the noise and cross-stock calculation of a design too. For example, among all the three paths on left-hand side figure, path 1 has gone through the largest path delay and arrivals later than the other two paths. Path 3 goes through the least number of gates and having shortest path delay. So the timing window for the signal on the input net to the D-pin is between the path 1 delay and path 3 delay. Timing graph-based analysis, GBA. There are two analyze strategies used in different phase of timing closure. GBA mode is short for timing graph-based analysis. In this mode, a timing arc could have only one set of most conservative rise and fall transition time. The timing window is propagated along the path. The principle is to guard band the entire path using worst case value. Let's assume the path above is a long path before the slow merge point. But it has a large drive strength inverter driving the NAND gate input, so it has a steeper transition. On the other hand, the path down below is a short path but its transition is slower. In GBA mode, we could have only one value for the slow to be propagated through this NAND gate. So according to the GBA principle, the slower one is picked for max timing path. This choice makes the upper paths more pessimistic after the slow merge point. The signal arrival time is within the range of a timing window no matter where the path it is coming from. Timing path-based analysis, PBA. In PBA mode, on the contrary, the slow and signal arrival time are calculated separately. Each path is isolated from each other so they don't interfere. This time, the faster transition is able to be propagated through the NAND gate so the above path could see a real transition even after the slow merge point. The signal arrival time is calculated specific to this path and it has only single switching edge. So we can calculate noise more accurately from it. Normally, PBA mode timing QOR is more accurate because of above reasons and should be always looks better than GBA mode. But since it has to isolate each path and store unique slew rate and arrival time for each timing node, it requires much more computing power to process this high volume of data. The normal strategy is to use GBA for timing closure when the design still has quite a lot failing path or timing violation. Then after all major timing problem have been solved and only very few tail paths left, we can enable PBA mode for accurate sign-off check. Topic 11, report timing paths. The most useful command of any STA tool would be the report timing command. Report timing in SINICIT tools all have similar behavior even though it might have differed a little bit from tool to tools. On the left side, the timing path is reported with the original command without any additional switch. Each output pin of the cells is reported along with the incremental delay going through each cell. This incremental delay value includes both the delay from the input wire and the delay introduced by the cell itself. More information is needed beyond that when we try to analyze a path or doing any kind of timing fix. So usually we have to append some additional switches to the original command. Just like the one shown on the right-hand side, The timing report now is showing input nets as well as the fanout for each net, the total capacitance shown on the wire and transition time for each signal rise and fall. According to these information, we can decide where has the potential to improve timing results, fixing speed timing path. The most common switches are listed here. Dashnet not only shows the net between pin nodes, but also show the number of fanouts for each net. Dash input shows the input pin through which the path is going through. It's useful when tracing report through multiple input cells. Also, it split the delay associate to a cell into net delay and cell delay. Dash trans shows both the input and output transition time used for or calculated by the delay calculation. Dash cap shows the total capacitance appear on the net, including both wire capacitance and input pin cap from next stage. If the timing constraints have been changed on the fly during debug, STA engine will need to recalculate the timing graph again. Even though report timing will retime the design implicitly and incrementally, it's always a good practice to do an explicit update timing before the next report underscore timing command. Chapter summary. In this chapter, we have gone through a lot of fundamental concepts of delay calculation. Firstly, we introduced timing arc, timing sense and timing path. Then two major cell delay models are our focus, the nonlinear delay model and composite current source model. We now know the CCS model has been developed to overcome the inaccuracy of NLDM when the interconnect resistance is relatively large compared to the driver resistance. Next we move on to the wire delay model, learned about the basic type of wire delay models including wire load model for pre-layout and distributed SPEF parasitic annotation for post-route. Since they are both RC tree, the way how the RC tree is typically calculated is also discussed. Last but not least, few easily got confused concepts have been clarified such as slow merging, min or max arc delay, analysis mode, and timing window. GBA and PBA mode concept has also been mentioned. Overall, this is a big trunk of design knowledge need to be understand for later study.